Okay, let's get started. First, I want to share with you my setup. So I've drawn a nice diagram here, hopefully a nice diagram. Let me show you what it is that I have here in front of me. So that's me, by the way. On my left here, or on your right, I think, this is my laptop. This is a laptop that you see the desktop of. Okay, there you can see the screen that you were just looking at now. On here, I'm running the radio management client, and I have also running radio management device processor. So this is my laptop. And then on my right here, this is the server. It's not a real server. It's not running Windows server. It's just running Windows 10. And I have the two PCs connected to the same Wi-Fi network. In addition to that, I have some radios here that we will program. So I have just have two portables here with me. And later on this week, we'll go and look at the repeater, which I have over there. That's a little bit outside the field of view of the camera. So if we have a look at it from a diagram point of view, I have, this is the server. I say server, very loosely the user's word server, onto which I have installed the radio management database. I've already have installed this, and included in there is the radio management database, the job processor, and I have the device programmer installed. I also have already installed the MNIS, MNIS. We'll come to that later this week, as well as DDMS. We'll come to that tomorrow. Then connected to this PC, I have a mobile radio, which you saw on my right hand side. This will be our control station. So this is what we will use partially for over-the-air programming. And then I also have connected to it through Ethernet a repeater. So this is a SLR 1000. I'm using it because it's a small repeater I can just put there. And of course, it doesn't have a fan running, so I don't have a lot of noise in this room while I'm busy working. Then on this PC in front of me, which you see the desktop of, I have running the radio management client as well as the device programmer. So I will use my PC to like program radios, and this will be done through the normal programming cable. So whatever programming cable matches that radio. Yeah, so that's basically my setup. So what I hope to achieve today, at least, is to get started with radio management. And the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to add some radios through USB. Okay, and we're going to add radios, and I'm going to briefly go through to set up those radios. We'll look at what we mean by configurations and sets, and then we'll get the radios working so they can at least talk to each other. And spelling mistake there. We'll get ready for OTAP, over-the-air programming, which we might be able to achieve today, but I'm going to aim to do OTAP via control station tomorrow, because there are some other things that we need to set up. Okay, so just so that you can get it, here are my contact details. So there's my email address if you want to write it down. If you have your mobile phone with you, you just go into the camera app on your smartphone and you scan this QR code in. It will give you all of my contact details will be added to your contacts on your phone. Okay, so let me go and start the radio management. Okay, so here I have the radio management client. It's already, the software is already installed. And here you can see in front of you is a blank database. So basically, this instance of radio management, it's got no radios in there. So it's a, I call it a blank database, or there are at least no radios in there. So what we need now to do is we want to add radios. And there are different ways that we can add radios. The first way is to add the radio and to, let's say, read the code plug using a programming cable. We can also import the code plug from either CPS or from another instance of radio management. So I give you an example, actually happened where we had one dealer who was maintaining a customer, and this company, they bought another company who were also using MOTOTRBO radios, but this other company, their radios were not set up in radio management. So we wanted to get all of these radios, let's say, into radio management. And what we've done is we got the dealer got the code plugs, and we went in and they imported them into radio management. So I'm going to show you the one way of doing it, and this is through adding the serial number and reading. So what I have in front of me is I have a programming cable. There you can see it's a standard DP4000 series programming cable. And I have, well, in this case, I only have two radios here with me, but I can add more, we'll add more radios as we go along. So what I want to do is I want to add this radio to radio management. So what I need to do is obviously connect the radio to my PC here. And I'll do that through the USB cable. Oops. Okay, it helps to plug it into a USB cable and not a SATA cable. So, so there's the radio there, it's connected. Now, what I need to do in radio management, or at least the radio management client, is I need to add this radio serial number. I can always, of course, I can always go and try to, let's say, get the serial number off the back of the chassis label there. There you can see the serial number is there. Okay, the resolution is not that great. I find that, for me personally, I find that a little bit difficult to do because the writing is very small for me. My eyes are not as good as they used to be. And also sometimes you can get like some, shall I say, finger trouble. You can forget to type the password correctly. So one of the tricks, or one of the cheating ways of doing it, is I use the device programmer. So I go onto my PC and I start the device programmer. Okay. What you see here in this window is basically what the device programmer is seeing. I just want to check. Yeah, I'm connected. Okay. What the device programmer is seeing in terms of what radios are connected. Okay, so now I'm going to turn this radio on. And as soon as the radio turns on, it's going to connect to the PC through USB. It's going to set up the driver. And as soon as that happens, the device programmer is going to see the radio. So there you can see, here's the radio that's connected to the PC. Okay, and here is its serial number. So instead of trying to type the serial number out manually by looking at the chassis label, I can just copy paste it from the device programmer. So in radio management, to add the radio, you click on add and you enter the serial number. That's all you need to do. Okay, there are some other fields here that you can enter if you want to. But my suggestion is that most of these things, these fields here below it are, let's say, generic, that you don't really have to worry about too much what to put in there. Sometimes what I do is I enter this CHI number, but even that you don't have to enter because it will always, in 99.999999999% of the cases, it will be 12. So even that you don't have to enter. You click OK, and now that serial number is added to radio management. The next thing that you need to do is you need to read the radio data out of the radio. You need to get what is inside the radio onto radio management, because there is at the moment no data exists about any radio. So to do that, what I need to do is I need to go click on the radio that I've just added, okay? And I can either go to right button click and say schedule job, or I can click on the radio or radios, multiple radios, and I can click on this button here at the top left-hand side, schedule job. It's got like a picture of a clock on it. Click on schedule job, and now it gives me some options here. What do I want to do? Well, I want to read the radio. I want to read the code plug, the radio's code plug. And when I read the radio's code plug, I want radio management to generate a configuration. Generating a configuration basically means that radio management creates a piece of data called a configuration that is used in this radio, but can also be used in other radios. So in radio management, we have this concept of a configuration and sets. So the way I explain it is I like to picture a set as a piece of data. So or a piece of data or like a Lego block. So let's say you want to build in Lego. I don't know if any of you have played with Lego or your children, they are playing with this, if you have small children or grandchildren. But a Lego block you can use to make a car, you can use to make a house, or you can make a ship, or you can make some kind of a building, a bridge, or anything like that. The block itself doesn't change. And that block can be used anywhere. So that would be a set. So you could have a block that is used in a car, and a block that is used, the same kind of block used in a house. And so in the same sense, sets in radio management can be shared between different configurations. So you have a configuration which is made up of different sets, and you can have a configuration shared between multiple radios. Or you could have a configuration per radio, and then that becomes a little bit complicated. So in this case, what I want to do is I want to read the radio, and I want to radio management to generate a configuration. And optionally, what I can do is I can say, well, when you read that configuration, apply that configuration, tie that configuration to the serial number that we have here. There are different ways that I can read the radio, but the most practical one and the only way that we can really do at this stage is to read the radio through USB, because we are not set up for OTAP yet, or any method. You can, if you have the possibility, you can read the radio using Wi-Fi. So when you select this, it says USB plus wireless LAN or Wi-Fi. So if the radio has Wi-Fi in, you can actually have that the radio, when it connects to a Wi-Fi access point, you can automatically have that it is read as soon as it is seen. Okay, so once I've selected those things, I can click OK. Okay, and now what will happen is that radio management will schedule a read job. Okay, so you can see now it's busy running. It's reading. It's read the radio. Radio restarts because we've read it. And now radio management shows a processing job. So this radio is now read, and we have the radio's configuration in radio management. So now we have basically all of the data about the radio. So we have the serial number. When we read the radio, we got the radio alias, the name that is shown on the screen. And we generated a configuration. And the name of the configuration, in this case, is the same as the serial number. So one of the things that I want to do here is I want to change the name of the configuration. If we carry on here, you can see that there are some other parameters in here, but we'll come back to that later. First thing I want to do is I want to change the name of this configuration. I can do it here, but where I'm going to go, and this is where we need to go, is I need to go here on the left-hand side. I need to click on Actions, Manage, and then Configurations. So here in this window, it brings us to the list of configurations we have in radio management. Since I've read the radio, it's generated a configuration. There is the name of the configuration, and it gives us some idea of what type of device it is. When was the last change made, and how many radios is this configuration connected to? It's only connected to one radio, but we will change that. We can edit this configuration. We can make changes to this configuration. And to do that, we can either right button click on it and say edit, or we can click on it and click on the little pen or pencil button here, edit. And when I do that, it brings up the configuration editor. And if you look here on the left-hand side, it's exactly the same as the CPS. So you have contacts, and you have channels and scan lists, all of these things that you would normally find in the CPS. So the first thing that I want to do here is I want to change the name of the configuration. At the moment, it just gives the default name, which is the serial number of the radio from where this configuration came. So I'm going to give this configuration a name, and I'm just going to call it config BP4801E1. Now, whenever you make a change in the set, you have to click on save. If you don't click on save, you will see now what happens is that Radio management says, "Oh, did you made some changes here? Do you want to save it?" "Yes, I want to save that configuration, or at least save that change that I made." Okay. Now I'm in the channels. Okay, and in the radio, I can see that there are two channels. Okay, and if I look at the frequencies that are used, they're down here. Okay, we can just go in and edit it. Okay, I can see that the frequencies that I'm going to be using, they are correct. I can see that the radio is set up to talk to the correct talk group. The power is low. I want to have the radio running on low power. Okay, so everything in terms of the radio configuration is okay. So I don't really need to make any changes here. I may take some small cosmetic things, but it's okay. I don't need to make any changes here. So for now, we can close this configuration, and we can go back to radio view, and we can now add the second radio. Okay. Now I made some small changes here in the code plug, or at least in the configuration. When I make a change in the configuration, you will see that in this column here, modified, there are some dots, okay? And the first dot here is now changed to color purple. Purple, as you can see, means that the code plug has been modified. Means that I've made some configuration change in the radio that requires this to be written back to the radio. Okay, but before I write this configuration change back to the radio, I am going to add another radio. So let me disconnect, and I'm going to plug in another radio. This is also a DP4801E. And let me get the serial number of it. There's it there. Okay, so I'm just using my cheat method of getting the serial number. Normally, you could add the serial numbers in by typing them in, or the other methods, which I will show you now. Okay, so let me just minimize that, and I'm going to add the serial number again. Okay. And in this case, I'm not going to read the radio. The reason is that this is also a DP4801E. It means that I don't have to actually read this radio, because I already have a configuration that will work on this radio. So I can do the following. So I add the serial number, there's it there, and what I can do now is I can go here, right button click, and say select configuration. But the problem is that it's grayed out. Radio management in this case will not allow me to select a configuration until I select another piece of information here called the MVO. So I've spoken to you about sets, I've spoken to you about configurations, and the third piece of data that is used to make up the code plug is this piece of data called the MVO. The MVO does not contain any configuration data. MVO stands for model version option. And it basically contains the information about what type of radio this is. Is it a mobile radio or is it a portable radio? Does it have these buttons or doesn't have buttons? Does it have a color display or a black and white display? So what we first have to do is when we add another radio, we have to say select MVO. And since it's the same model of radio, I can go in here and I can just simply select an existing MVO. So use the first radio's MVO data in the second radio because they are the same model number. They're the same radio, same frequency, everything. So I can select the one MVO and use it in the second radio. Okay. I see here one thing I need to change. I want to change the radio alias. I want to make it radio 101. Okay. And then I also want to come here and I also need to change the radio ID. So I want to remember that on a MOTOTRBO radio system, every radio must have a unique radio ID. Okay, now that I've done that, I can now go and say select configuration. And you can see that the configuration that we were looking at a short while ago is there, it's listed, and I can say okay and use that. So what we've done is we've read one radio, we've made some changes in the configuration, and we're going to use that same configuration in a second radio. You could add a third or a fourth, even 1,000 radios, and use that same configuration in all the radios if you wanted to. So typically what you would have in a real system is you would have one configuration per department or per user type. So thinking of a factory, the maintenance department would have their radio configuration. That is assuming that they all use the same model of radio. Okay, so if you have users, maybe from the same team, but have different models of radios, each radio model would need to have its own unique configuration. But the configuration would have the same data in it. And so we'll see later, we can copy configuration information from one configuration to another. It becomes a little bit, I will show you, it's a little bit too much to explain in words. So I've created now the second radio. The first radio, I've made some changes to the code plug. What I can do now is I can now put these changes back into the radios. And to do that, I need to select the radios that I want to write the information back to. And I can click on this schedule job, the orange clock button, or I can right button click and say schedule job. But before I do that, okay, and it's always a good idea to do it, is to run analyze. What analyze does is it goes through the configuration and it makes some checks. And basically it checks to make sure that you have not made any mistakes. So it's like an error checking facility in radio management. So we right button click and we say analyze. And what it will do is it goes through and it checks all the settings in the radio. Okay. And if there are any problems, it will come up with this. Now, if you look here, There are the two radios, and you can see that both of them have got this no entry sign. And it says here, what is the problem? It says that in this place here, security, rest keys, rest key value, blah, blah, blah. Value is not set. Value must be set before performing a write job. It means that when I read the configuration, in there, there was a rest key programmed into the radio. Rest meaning restricted access to system. It's one of the things that we have in MOTOTRBO. It's like a protection mechanism for radios and repeaters. And these two radios have got a RAS enabled, but I did not put a RAS key in. So I have to fix that. So I can either go through and delete RAS. Too many steps to do that. It's actually easier for me just to go and fix that by adding the RAS key, doing what is suggested. To do that, I need to go to the actions, the green gear button, actions, manage, and I go to RAS keys. Okay, so there are some leftover data here, so I'm just going to delete that one, and I'm just going to use this. I'm just going to enter a RAS key value. So I'm just going to use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then go back to radio view again. Let's try this again. Analyze. So I'm going to analyze again. And let's check the results. So we click on the bottom left here. And you can see now that both radios has got the green tick next to it. Means that it's okay, it can be used. So what I can now do is right button click, schedule job, and now I can write over USB. So I click OK. And now what will happen is that radio management will construct a code plug. This code plug will be sent to the device programmer. I'll just clear that. And as soon as the radio is seen, it will start to write the code plug to that radio. So I've got device programmer open here. And you can see now there's already the first job ready and waiting. This radio is connected, so it starts writing straight away. So that radio is now done, and it will restart with the new configuration. Okay. Let's connect the other radio. And as soon as the device programmer sees that radio, it will be written. The code plug will be written to the radio. And there it goes there. Then this radio will restart with its new configuration. Okay, so we can just check to make sure that the radio is working okay. They can talk to each other. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Hello, hello, hello. Okay, so the radios are now set up. They're ready to use. And we can then start thinking about some other possibilities. Any questions so far? Okay, so far so good. If you have any questions while I'm busy showing the stuff, you can always type the questions into the chat and I will pick them up as we go along. I said to you that we can also import radios into radio management. You can go here at the top of the radio view. What I mean by radio view is that you can go click on the database and have different kinds of views. There is a system view, there is what we call job view that shows all the previous tasks that you've done. So the most of the time you would be looking at the radio view. Now, one of the things you've noticed here is that now that I've read the radios, I mean, and I've programmed them, you can see that under the column here, job status, it shows as completed. Also, you will see that under the modified column, all these dots are gray. So to import a radio into radio management using a code plug, we need to go here. So at the top under radio view, there is this button here. It's got a round button. It's got three dots in it. You click on that and you click on import. Okay. You can import a radio using a saved code plug. So let me try to find a code plug here if I have one. Yeah, okay, I'm just going to use this one over here. So I have a code plug which I've just saved on my PC here. I just call it, it's called the sample DP4601E. So I can open this code plug. This is a code plug that was edited using CPS or read from the radio using CPS and saved on the computer. So I can just open that file, and now you can actually import this code plug into radio management. So I can say create the radio, create the configuration, and apply the configuration to that radio, and we say import. And what it does is it reads the code plug file and adds that radio now to radio management. So you can see there's the serial number, the alias, and all the usual information that you would expect that you would have in radio management. The other possibility is to add the serial numbers in using a spreadsheet. So the radios that are shown in radio management, you can actually take the information, what you see here under radio view, and you can export this to an Excel spreadsheet. So I can take all of these radios here and say export, and I can actually export this into Excel. So I just call this a radio list. I can save that. And if I go to my desktop, you can see here is a list of the serial numbers with the configurations and all the other information. Using that, what you can do now is you can go and complete this list, add in all your serial numbers, specify the configurations that you want to use, for example, the radio IDs you want to use, and then save that information, and you can actually import that back into radio management by clicking on this button over here, this import button. And what it does is it will import the Excel spreadsheet back into radio management. So I would say a pretty useful feature to have with this import and export from Excel, especially if you have lots and lots of serial numbers. Okay, I just want to remove this radio. So you can actually remove radios if you don't want them anymore in radio management. To do that, you just simply go right button click on the radio and you say delete. Okay, that will remove the radio from the database, but it doesn't remove the configuration. So if you go back here and you say manage configurations, you can see that the configuration for the radio that you've just deleted is still there. So if you add the radio again or another radio, another similar radio again, you need to be a little bit careful about having a duplicate configuration or a configuration with the same name. So if you're going to delete a radio completely, you should also maybe think about also deleting its configuration, if that is the case. Okay, so we've added our two radios now to radio management. I don't see any questions. Are there any questions so far? Are you all okay? Are you all keeping up? Okay, let me know if I'm going too fast or I'm going too slow. I can always adjust. So I have now the database that is created. I have two radios in the database. These two radios are set up correctly. I can now continue and I can now start looking at some other things, maybe to go and program these radios over the air. So to program a radio over the air, we can do over the air programming through a different ways, but the one that I want to show you today is through a control station. Sorry about that. I'll just try that again. Yeah. So you can program the radios through Wi-Fi. You can do it over the air or through a programming cable. Through Wi-Fi, it's a bit difficult for me to show you, but we'll try to look at that later. We've seen that we can program radios from radio management using a programming cable. And we can also program radios over the air. And there are two ways to program the radio over the air. One is by using a repeater or a radio system and using a piece of software known as MNIS. We'll come to that later. Or we can program radios over the air using a control station. So I always get asked, what is a control station? A control station is basically a MOTOTRBO radio connected to a computer running usually the device programmer and some other software. So it can be a mobile radio or it can be a portable radio. It doesn't really matter. In this case, we're going to use a mobile radio, a DM 4601. Normally you'd want to use a mobile radio because it would be installed in a cabinet somewhere in a rack, was connected to an external antenna and will have a 12 volt DC supply with battery backup, etc. Though you can use a portable radio. The only thing, of course, is that the portable radio, it has a battery. You have to make sure that the battery is always connected, and of course the portable radio, it's not so easy to connect it to an external antenna. So the most practical solution for a fixed installation would be to use a mobile radio. So the connection between the connection between radio and PC is through USB. It's a standard USB cable. So in this case, you would use the programming cable, the radio's programming cable. In the case of a mobile radio, I suppose you could make your own cable, but it's probably easier, save yourself all the hassle. It's easier probably just to use the standard mobile programming cable. So this plugs in either on the front or on the back. And then when you plug this cable into a PC, it will ask to install a driver. You install the driver. We have a driver for the radio. And what this driver does is it sets up it's an RNDIS driver. RNDIS is basically a specification from Microsoft, which basically allows you to have a USB device providing a network connection. So when you install the driver on the PC, and when the radio is connected, the PC will see the radio as a network connection with a gateway with IP address. And the PC will get an IP address from the radio using DHCP. So there is actually, from a PC point of view, the control station becomes like a network connection. And so we use, to program the radios over there, we use a combination of a TCP over IP and UDP over IP. In Windows, we need to tell Windows how to reach the radios. And so we will use a command called Windows root, the root command, to set up a route between the computer network, the computer's IP address, this network connection to the radio, and the radio network. Okay. In addition to that, we will also use some other things. One of the things that you need to have when you're doing over-the-air programming is you need to have a feature enabled in the radios called ARS, Automatic Registration Service. If you have a capacity MAC system, you don't need to worry about that. But in other systems, so IP Side Connect, capacity plus, etc., you need to have this feature ARS. What ARS does is it tells the radio when it switches on. When it switches on, it should send a message, an ARS message, to, in this case, the control station. So here, when radio A switches on, radio A will switch on and it will say, I'm here. It will send its radio ID to the control station. We will set up the control station to send this information to the PC. And on the PC, we will have a piece of software installed called DDMS. Another abbreviation for you to remember, Device Discovery and Mobility Service. It's basically the software that keeps a record of which radio is turned on and which radio is turned off. We need this for radio management. We need this for over-the-air programming, because when you plug a radio into the PC to program it through USB, which we have done this morning, it's very easy because the PC can see the radio because it's connected. It's physically connected through a piece of wire to that radio. And the radio is sending a message out on the USB connection to say, here I am. Since we are doing, if we're going to do over-the-air programming, there is no physical connection between this radio A here and the PC. So we need to have some mechanism to discover when radio A is turned on. So when radio A turns on, it will send this ARS message to the control station. The control station will just send this through to the PC, and this will go to DDMS. DDMS will say, ah, okay, radio A is turned on. And this information will be stored. When the device programmer comes to program, for example, doing OTAP to radio A, it will check with DDMS and it will say, is radio A turned on? DDMS will say yes or no. If yes, then device programmer will start to program the radio. It will try to send the OTAP information to, in this case, radio A. Okay. Any questions on that? Is it clear enough? Okay. So when you're doing over-the-air programming, you need to enable in the radios that are going to be programmed over there, you need to enable ARS. And on the PC, which is handling the control station, the PC which is connected to the control station, you need to have DDMS. The control station itself needs to have some special configuration. The first thing is that it needs to have a unique radio ID. This ID will be used as a destination for ARS. So when we come to the radios and look at the radios, you will see that there we need to say, okay, I need to have ARS enabled. We will check that. And I need to send my ARS message to a number, to a radio. Which radio? The control station. And this control station needs to have a unique radio ID. In the configuration of the control station, there is a setting there called forward to PC via USB cable. We need to make sure that that is enabled. And we also need to enable this data call acknowledged. So when radio A sends an ARS message to the control station, we want to have that the control station sends an acknowledgement back to radio A to say ARS received. Because if radio A does not get an acknowledgement, what radio A will do is it will resend the ARS message, which is not a big deal. But if you have 1,000 radios out there trying to send ARS over and over again, it's going to create absolute havoc. So in the control station, you need to have that the data call, in this case ARS, is acknowledged. The frequencies and color codes must match what is used in the radio. So the control station, the control station and the radio, so this control station and radio A must be configured in such a way that they can at least talk to each other. So you could plug in a microphone into the control station, press the PT, and you should be able to talk to radio A. Because obviously if the control station cannot talk to radio A, it means that they are not on the same frequency, they're not on the same color code, they're not on the same channel, etc. So you need to make sure that at least from a voice point of view, you can make a call between the two radios. Okay, as long as that is okay, then it should work. So let's go look firstly at the configuration of these two radios. We said that these radios here, they should have ARS enabled. So instead of going in here and changing each one, what I can do is I can go to Manage, Configurations, and you can see that we've got this config DP4801E, which we created earlier. Okay, and you can see that they apply, this configuration is used by two radios. So that means all I have to do is I have to make the change here once, and that change is applied to all the radios which use this configuration here. So ARS is under general and under network. So if I go there, I can see some information. The first thing I can see that is it's already set up, but the ARS radio ID is 99. Okay, that's good. I saved myself some time. So I just need to write this number down, 99. So this radio was already set up. Okay, I cheated a little bit this morning. I set this radio up, and I set it up to go to send its ARS message to radio 99. That's cool. What made me choose 99? Well, it can be any number. In the documentation, they suggest a number. In some of the other application suppliers, they suggest a number. For ARS, for the radio ID, all it needs to be is unique. And whenever I'm putting a system together, what I do personally is I say, okay, the first 100 radio IDs I allocate to applications, dispatch, location tracking, impress fleet management, whatever. Those first block of radio IDs are reserved. The radios can go from, in this case, radio 101 right up to 16 million. But here I want to have the first few radio IDs reserved for special purposes, like in this case, ARS. So I've just made this one a 99. You can put whatever number you want in there, as long as that number is unique. So ARS, we have a ARS radio ID already set up in there, and I'm just going to go check in the channels to make sure that I have ARS enabled. So I go down to the zone, and I go into one of the channel one in this case, and I scroll down, and I can see here there is a drop down. It's called ARS. Okay, by default it's set as disabled, but here I have it as set up already as on system change. So if you look at the possibilities here, you can have the radio will send ARS when on system change. What is meant by system change is if the user changes channel on their radio. Okay. Or you can have it disabled, the radio will never send ARS. Or you can use on system stroke site change. This is set to orange because radio management sees that this is a simplex channel and there is no IP side connect set up in this radio. So it puts it on red because it's telling you that you cannot really select this. So in this case, I just have to put here on system change. If I had to put on system stroke side change, what would happen is that the radio would send ARS every time the user changed the channel, or the radio roamed between sites. So what it was is sufficient. I can just click on close. It may ask me if I want to save the settings. I don't want to. I'm just going to check on the other channel. And just see what I have here. Yeah, ARS is also enabled on this channel. So that's good. That's great. I don't need to make any changes in the radio configuration. That's fantastic. So I can leave these radios as they are. And I can carry on, and I can add now the control station to the system. Any questions so far? Okay. Now I'm going to read the control station. I'm going to add the control station to the database. Now, the control station is not connected to my PC. In this case, the control station is connected to the, and I use the word very loosely here, the control, the PC. So here is the radio management server. Here is the control station. And here, you can just make it out, is the cable that connects the control station to that PC. Okay, so it's connected through USB to the radio server. So I need to go here on my desktop and I need to go into the server. So this is no longer my PC. What you see in front of you is remote desktop and I've connected to the radio management server. Okay. And if I go here into a device programmer, you can see that I have this radio, it's connected to the PC. Okay. Here is this radio, here is the control station, here is its serial number. So I can actually go and copy that. Just get rid of all this other stuff. And I can go back to the radio management client on my PC and just add the serial number there. So I'm using my cheat method again, if you want to call it that. I mean, you can add it in through Excel if you want to. I showed you that already. Or you can enter the serial number in manually if you wanted to. But I'm just being, I don't know, either lazy or overcautious. So I just add the serial number, okay? So there's the serial number added. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to right button click and schedule job. Now this is a new radio, a new type of radio that I'm reading here. So I'm going to say read and I'm going to say generate a configuration and apply that to the radio. Okay? When I read, I want to read over USB. And I can click on OK. So now what's going to happen is that radio management is going to start reading the radio. And because the radio is connected to a device programmer, another device programmer is going to see it and it's going to read it. So you can see it's busy read. The radio now restarted, as you heard. And we have the radio now added to the radio management database. So now I can begin to set this radio up as a control station. So what do I need to do? Well, the first thing I want to do is I want to change the radio alias. And I want to call this here control station. And I'm just going to call it 99. Oh, no, not run out of space. I just call it CS. And then... or something like that, control is T. I'm just going to call it 99. Just, you can call it whatever. You just give it it's just a name. Okay. This is the name that will be shown on the screen when the radio switches on. Okay. Then I want to also change the radio ID. This radio has a default radio ID of 1. I want to change this to 99 because we said that when the other radios, the portable radios that I have here, these other two radios here, when they switch on, they should send their ARS and they should send it to radio 99. So I want to have this. This is the radio that will receive this ARS message from the radios. Now I want to go and set this radio up so that it can work on the system, so or at least work on the channel. So what I can do is I can go to Manage and Configurations, And there you will see is the radio that we've just read, this DM4601. And there is, you can see that it's connected to one radio. And here is the name of the configuration. I want to change that. I'm just going to call it. I'm just going to call it control station. Okay. And let's go set this radio up. So I'm not going to go through every single thing. Okay. All the stuff is pretty standard. So you would set the radio up according to the system requirements. The only things that we do need to do in this radio is we need to set this radio up such that when it receives any data over the air, it should send it to the computer. And this setting you will find here under general settings, under network, under radio network, and you will see that there is this drop down here called forward to PC. What we need to select here is via USB. So any data that comes into this radio over the air, this radio will send out to whatever, to a PC via USB. Okay. We don't need to set this radio up for ARS because it is the target for ARS. So we don't need to have this radio sending ARS messages to itself. So we don't need to worry about having ARS radio ID, but we do need to have this set up to go forward the traffic to the PCs through USB. The next thing we need to do in this radio is we need to set it up so that it can talk to the other portable radios. So we need to go add in, just need to press save. We need to add in channels, okay? So this radio has some arbitrary channels in here. I suppose I should use them, but I don't want these channels. I don't know what is in there. I'm just going to just put one holder here. So I just want to, what I'm trying to do here is just to, let's say, get rid of the channels that are in there. Okay, now I want to get the channels from the portable radios. I want this radio to talk to the portable radios. I can go through and I can go edit. I can go add channels and enter the frequencies. Or what I can do is I can go click on the triple dot button here and I can say, I can go in here. That's over here. My mistake. Sorry. No, it's up here. Save that. Sorry, let me try that again. What you can do is you can say, okay, I want to get the channels from the portable radios. And to do that, I just go here to the zone and I right button click and I say, copy set from portable radios. So I can actually copy the channels in the portable radios and use them again here. So I just copy them across. They are I see there are two zones in there, but I'll add both. Okay. And now I already have all these zones, or at least the channels added to the radio. Okay, so let me just go there and just go click on it. So there you can see are the two channels that I copied from the portable radio. So I didn't need to enter anything. Everything is already there. So just for completeness, I'm just going to delete this. I don't need that anymore. I can proceed that way anyway. The other thing that I just want to get from the other, from the portable radios, we can do that again, is I can also copy the contact list from the other radio. So copy set from there, say okay. Select the contacts I want to copy. So there's only two here, but I will just copy those two across. And that's now added. Okay. So I can, let me just delete that. Okay, I can remove the things I don't want. That's okay, we'll see now. Okay, let me just go back to these channels. Just make sure that I done everything right. The channel name is there. The color code is right. ARS, it doesn't really matter. And disable ARS, don't need that. Everything else seems to be okay. There are already the frequencies. Always confirmed. Okay, that seems to be okay. Oops, sorry, close. Okay, so I've added the two channels now. I can hit save, and then we can go back to radio view, and we can put this code plug back into the radio. But before we do that, we need to go right button click and say analyze. Analyze will check to make sure that I didn't make any mistakes. And guess what? I made 246 of them. Okay. A lot of them are repeats of the previous ones.
2 hours later.
Them. Okay. Pity. You can delete the zone. Okay, let's see if we can do that. That might help. Okay, that might help. Let me try to do that again. Just run analyze once more. Okay, there's still some mistakes. Okay, the selected set no longer exists. That's okay. We can just remove that. Save. Let's go to the next one. Then RX, this no longer exists. Go to there and just remove it. The thing is if you delete something somewhere, it might be used elsewhere. And so you have to be a little bit careful when you delete it. So that's what I've done. I was not careful enough. And so whatever that means. Okay. So let's save that. Let's try do the analyze again to make sure that I did not miss anything else. Okay, so you can see that the radio is now got the green tick. So we managed to clear all those errors, a little bit of a slight detour there. And now I can write this radio. So I can schedule job. And I can say write through USB and I can click okay. And now, what will happen is it creates the code plug and it will write it to the radio. In this case, through USB. Let's go have a look at it. So there is fantastical about DDMS, the installation. So you just install it and it installs and it starts. Generally, there is nothing that you there is nothing to configure in there. The only time that you would change some configurations is if a DDMS and device programmer are sitting on different computers, so different physical computers. In that case, then you need to do some settings there. Okay. So here I have a DDMS. I've installed it. As I said, there is nothing magical about the installation. It just installs and that's it. I'm just going to show you some aspects of what is in there. There are two things that are important or that are relevant when we come to set up the device programmer. The first of these is this port watcher. So basically, this is the port, I believe it's TCP port, that the device programmer and DDMS will talk on. So when DDMS gets an ARS message from the radio, it will store this information. And when the device programmer wants to check whether a radio is on or if it's off, it will talk to DDMS using this UDP port. The other thing that you need to check is here. The other one is this setting here, which is the IP address of DDMS. Now, since DDMS and the device programmer in this case are sitting on the same PC, you would put in this IP address here. So this is the IP address of the own of let's say its home, its own IP address. So you put in here, if it's going to be on the same PC, you will just use this IP address here, 127.0.0.1. It's a very famous IP address. It just basically tells DDMS that it's on the same machine. Device programmer is on the same machine. The other thing that you need to make sure, and it's already there, but you need to make sure that this at the top left here, this I call it a play button, that this button is grayed out. Grayed out means that DDMS is running. Okay. If you had to click on the stop button, basically it would stop DDMS, and then you would perhaps run into problems. Okay, so that's DDMS, that's working fine. I'm going to put that aside now. And now what I need to do is I need to go look at the device programmer and make sure that the device programmer is talking to DDMS. So to do that, I need to start the device programmer. So this is basically like the user interface of the device programmer. Normally, it's just running as a service. So there's nothing you need to do. You don't need to open this window. It will just be there running as a service on the PC. But in this case now, we need to go in there and we need to go into settings. Okay. Then there are a few things we need to do here. Okay, you can also select a USB if you want, but what we have to do now is, since we're going to be using OTAP, over-the-air programming, we need to select over-the-air. Okay, what that does is it tells the device programmer to connect to the radios using OTAP. So this could either be through a control station or it could be through MNIS. We'll come to MNIS tomorrow. But for now, we're going to use a control station. Okay, good. When we select over the air, we are asked for some more information here. We are asked for a PN server. PN stands for Presence Notification. It's what DDMS does. So when you see PN server, it means it's the where DDMS is installed. And we say, yes, do we want to use a pre-end server? Yes, we want to. And the IP address of DDMS is, well, it's on the same PC. It's 127.0.0.1, and it's port UDP port, TCP port 3000. To make sure that DDMS is talking to the device programmer, we can go in here and we can say, click on test connection. What that does is that it makes device programmer connect to DDMS and grab some information. If the connection is good, if DDMS is running and there are no problems, then you will see there, when you click on it, it says success. So that tells you that the device programmer and DDMS can now talk to each other. There are some other settings. These are not, at the moment, not important. The only thing I would say is there is this setting here, job pacing. What job pacing does is that if you're going to be doing, if you're going to be writing a lot of radios using OTAP, what you can do is you can have that, you can put in a gap in between each OTAP job. So you want to have that the radios are written, but you want to give like maybe 5 minutes pause between each one, then you can do that by entering a value or job pacing value. Here, we're only going to be working with two portable radios, so I don't need to put any value in there. I can just leave that as blank. Now, whenever you make a change in the settings of the device programmer and you click OK, it's going to update those settings. But what also the device programmer needs to do is it needs to restart. So if I click OK, it will say the settings will only take effect once the service is restarted. That's fine. Click OK. And it will reboot. So now DDMS and device programmer are talking to each other. Okay. Now, the next thing we need to do is we now need to create a route between the device programmer, the network of the computer, the network connection of the computer, and the radio network. Okay. So basically what we're doing here is we're telling device programmer that in order to reach radios on the radio network, you need to use this gateway here. Okay. So you see a bunch of IP addresses here. Okay. The first IP address range that you see here, this 12.0.0.0, this is the IP address range used by the radios. Every MOTOTRBO radio has a IP address. That IP address is made up of the CHI number. By default, this is 12, plus the radio ID. So we can actually go, if we want, and this is one of the tests that we'll do to make sure that it's working, is you can actually go ping a radio using the ping command. You can actually ping the radio's IP address. This is the subnet mask for that range there. And this IP address here is the IP address of the control station. So when the control station is connected to the PC, it will obviously be set up as an RNDIS network adapter. So it will get an IP address. And so you're basically telling Windows by using this root command to, in order to access any IP address in this range, you need to go through this gateway here. To make sure that it's working okay, we would use this command here, root print. Okay. But before I even do that, I I have to do one more thing in the radio. Over-the-air programming can potentially be, I would say, maybe a little bit dangerous thing, because what you could have is you could have somebody come and try to program your radios over the air. All they would need is a laptop with a control station or whatever. That could be a bit dangerous. So one of the features we have in radio management and with OTAP is we have this feature called the OTAP key. So in order to program a radio over the air, the device programmer needs to send to the radio this key. If the key does not match, the radio will not accept the programming. If the key matches, the radio will accept the programming and the over-the-air programming rights job can go ahead. So before we can use the, let's say, radio management, or at least before we can use OTAP, we have to set up in the radios, we have to add this OTAP key, and we have to add it in radio management. Okay. So let's do this first. Before we get on to play with the adding a root, let's first add the OTAP key to the radios. So I'm going to go back to the radio management client, which is here. Okay, so there you can see are the radios. So these are the radios that we were working with yesterday, the two portables and the control station. There they are there. So there's the two portable radios now. And I want to program those radios over the air. But before I can do that, I need to give those radios the key. I need to give them a OTAP key. To do that, I need to go here. I need to click on the green actions button and I need to click on manage and I need to go click on OTAP keys. Now you can see that there is already a key there, but we don't know what that key is. And it was a key that was left over in these radios. So we cannot use that key. We have to enter a key value. So I'm gonna put in a key that we can use, and I'm gonna just enter here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So that's gonna be our OTAP key. When you put in a thing like that, an OTAP key, remember that it is write only. So if somebody gets you the radio or whatever, and they try to read the radio, they will not know what this OTAP key is. Okay. So the radio will not know what the OTAP, if anyone tries to read your radio, they will not see the OTAP key because the OTAP key is write only. You can only write it. If you read it, you can see that it comes up with this empty value. Okay. So that OTAP key is there now. If I go back to the radio view, I don't see anything there. What I do need to do is I need to go make sure that it is in the configuration. So I need to go click on actions, manage, configurations, and I need to go look at the configuration that is used by those two radios. So I go in there and I edit. Okay, and then I need to go to general, and then I need to go to security. So general, security, and if you scroll right down, okay, here there's all the encryption keys. This is all standard Codeplug stuff, but the one that I'm interested in is to see whether the OTAP key is there. So the OTAP key is in the radio already, or at least in the configuration already. So that's okay, but I need to make sure that this key is, let's say, put back into the radio. Now, it would be nice if I could do this over the air, but unfortunately, the radios are not ready yet to be programmed over the air. Sure, we've made sure that the OTAP key it's there. That's fine. That's all good. But I don't think that this information is in the radio. So what I need to do is I need to write these radios once more for the last time using USB. Okay. So I schedule the job, and now I need to plug the radios into the PC to be written. So programming cable in. And then as soon as the radio is seen, it will get its new code plug. Okay, so that one's done. Let's do the next guy. Whoops, sorry about that. Okay, so once this radio is done, now both of those portable radios are ready for over-the-air programming. One thing that you'll notice is that I did not put the OTAP key into the control station. The reason is that this OTAP key is not generated by the control station. The OTAP key is generated by the device programmer. So only the device programmer needs to know what the OTAP key is. The control station is just the control station. It's just the gateway for sending data. Yesterday, I had connected to the, let's say, the laptop, which I call my radio management server. I have connected a MOTOTRBO mobile, the M4601. That's connected to the PC, which is I call my server. This is the desktop of that server. We've seen this already this morning. The control station is connected to the PC, and I can show you this because if I go into the PC and I go to the device manager, okay, and we go down here to network adapters, you can see there that one of the entries in there is a MOTOTRBO radio number 9. This is the control station. So the control station is connected to the PC. The PC sees the control station as a network adapter because it's we've installed the correct driver. Okay. Because we have that network connection, if we go here to network adapters, so you can see that there are two network adapters. One is a physical Ethernet. We'll come to that later. I just want to show you the... That's better. Let's go into this one here. So this is the computer's Wi-Fi. This is the Ethernet, physical Ethernet. But the one that I want to show you is the control station. So this network 9 is the control station. If I click on there, on this... Ethernet, and I go to properties. Just go to details. Actually, it's easier there. So there you can see is the IP address of the control station. Okay. So now our task is to go create a route between the MOTOTRBO radio network, the MOTOTRBO 12 subnet, and the network on the PC. Okay, so between this IP address and the MOTOTRBO radio network. So to do that, I need to go to the command prompt. So I just search here, and I just search for CMD. Okay, so this is the Windows command prompt. And as a precaution, it's always a good idea to run it as administrator. Okay. And in here, we need to type in a command. And this command will tell the device programmer, in order to connect to the radios, in order to send data to the radios, you need to go through the control station. So to do that, we type in root P. What does the P do? The P creates a root, but it is what we call a persistent root. It means that that root will stay in the computer even after it is rebooted. Okay. Then we need to put in the IP address range for the MOTOTRBO radios, and that was a 12.0.0.0. Then mask the subnet. Then the gateway. Okay. So we press enter, and it was Windows accepted it. Okay. We can check to make sure that we've done it right by typing root print. Okay. And what this does is it makes the PC display all the roots that are on the PC. So you can see that here we have our entry. Okay, and it has the interface metric of 56, which is good. So the root is there. Good. So that looks nice. Now we can go and do some checks to make sure that everything is working right. One of the things that we can do to start off with is to ping the control station. You can see there that that's working. So that tells us that we have an IP connection to the control station. Okay. That's good. Now we can also even try to ping the radios. So I need to make sure that the radios are turned on. They're on the same frequency or the same channel as the control station. And then I can type ping 12.0.0. And I'm going to pick one of the radios, radio 101. Okay, so that is the IP address of radio 101. Now, MOTOTRBO is not a broadband connection. The speed that we can get in best case scenario is about 1 kilobit per second. So it was not designed for high speed, low latency connectivity. So when we do things like ping, we have to be a little bit patient. And so we have to tell Windows, okay, before timing out, just wait a few seconds. So I usually put in here, it should be enough, but you put in a dash W and 5,000. So this basically tells the ping command just to wait 5 seconds before timing out. So let's try and ping this radio and see what happens. Okay. So there you can see we have a reply back from the radio. That tells me now that I have an IP connection between the PC, the radio management server, and the radios themselves. It says to me that we can now try out radio management over the air programming. So I'm just going to come back to our radios here. You can see that we've written them. There's nothing that has changed since, so there is no need for us to do anything. To try out radio, to try out over-the-air programming, what I'm going to do is I'm going to program a button on the radio. I'm going to say, okay, I want to have one of the programmable buttons to do a certain function. Here, I have this radio here, okay, and you see the button underneath the PTT button, this button here, side button two. If I press on it, you can hear that if I press on it, it has no function, okay? It's not doing anything. So what I want to do is I want to change the function of this button, okay? I want to put some function on it. We'll come to see what that function is now. So let me go to my to radio management, and let me go into the configuration for these two radios here. So actions, manage configurations. I go to configuration that is used by those two radios. Okay, and this is standard code plug stuff, standard CPS stuff. So there's nothing, I would say, nothing spectacular here. And you just need to go down to control buttons. So these are how the buttons on the radio. And you can see that currently side button two, it's just showing is unassigned. So side button two currently is set to unassigned, meaning no function. So I want to change that, and I'm going to put in, I'm going to put here radio name. Okay, so pressing that button now will make the radio show its radio ID and its alias on the screen. Okay. So if I make a change, I just need to save it. Okay, and now if I go back to radio view, you can see that the configuration for those two radios has changed. There is this purple dot here. It's coming up as purple. That says to me that there is an update in the code plug. Okay. Now I want to put this code plug into the radio. And I'm going to do it through over-the-air programming. So I select the radios that I want to program. Okay. But before I do that, always a good idea, before you write a radio in radio management, to avoid surprises, right button click and say analyze. Analyze will go through, it will check the configuration. If you've made any mistakes, it will let you know. Right click here at the bottom, you can see that both radios have got the green tick next to it, showing that the analyze was okay. There are no mistakes like we had yesterday. That's good. And now I can right button click and I can say schedule job. Now I'm going to write the radio, but instead of doing it through USB, okay, the cable is not connected to the PC at all, I'm going to select over the air. So it's gonna write the radio, but it's gonna do this over the air. So we're just going to send this configuration change to the radio. One of the beauties with over-the-air programming is that when you make a small change like that, radio management will not send the whole code plug to the radio. It only sends the information about that change. So that makes over-the-air programming, let's say, relatively efficient in that there is not a lot of data that needs to be sent over the air. It's only relatively small amount of data that needs to be sent. So when I click OK here, what's going to happen is that radio management, or specifically the job processor, is going to construct the code plug, and that's going to be sent to the device programmer. The device programmer is going to send this to the radio over the air using the control station. So there you can see is already the first job appeared. And what it's going to do now is it's going to talk to the radios. It's going to say, where is this radio? And it's going to start doing its thing. So you can see there, it's already started with this radio here, radio 102. And here you can see now it's starting to write the information. I don't know which radio this is, but we'll soon see. Okay, there is a lot of handshaking that happens in the background that you don't really notice. I think it's this one here. Okay. When the write is finished, the radio will restart with the new configuration. So this radio is done, and you hear it will restart now. So we're going to be, this radio is going to be programmed now. And what I wanted to show you is what happens once the OTAP job is complete. So you can see there's some activity on the screen. You can see that the radio is transmitting. So this is like kind of a checks that it's doing. And then you will see that there is this icon here showing that it's receiving an OTAP job. The icon is like a page with two arrows on it. So the real thing happens when the radio starts, once this OTAP job is complete. You can see there it's busy doing it now. Let's come back to the radio again. Once the job is complete, you will see it'll restart. So now the radio has restarted with the new configuration. So you'll hear it will reboot in a second. It's busy rebooting now. Okay. Now you can see that in the device programmer, both of those radios are coming with the green tick, so they are done. And if we go to the radio management client application, you will see that both of the radios now, they are showing as completed, and you can see that the purple dot has changed. Now, to prove to you that I did actually OTAP the radio, here you can see the same radio again. And remember, when I pressed this button, there was no function. So when I press this button now, you can see it comes up and it shows the radio name. Okay, so it has now this function assigned to it. And the process would be the same if you wanted to add or remove channels or add or remove contacts. It's exactly the same concept that you've been using as you would do with CPS or whatever. Okay. And I've went and I've installed MNIS. The installation of MNIS is nothing spectacular to look at. You just run the setup file and you click accept and you click next, 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 you click OK. And I think it asks for a reboot. Reboot your PC, it will start up and you'll have MNIS running. When you start MNIS for the first time, it starts up, but it starts up like, shall I say, blank. There is no configuration data in it. It is not running. So to start MNIS, we would need to make some adjustments. And to do those, we would need to know some information about the repeater and about our MOTOTRBO radio network. So before I get too carried away with MNIS here, I need to go look at the configuration of this repeater. I mean, I can set up MNIS. I know what is in the repeater, but I would like just to show you the repeater. So I'm just going to plug in the repeater into my laptop PC. Okay. And let's go into radio management. And let's see what's inside this repeater, because I need to take some information from the repeater and put that into MNIS. You'll see it now. Okay, it's gonna bomb out because it doesn't have the new IP address. One of the things I would have liked to have done on this laptop is to run like a DNS, so that you just have to enter a domain name. Lots of passwords. This password is Motorola123, by the way. I have enough difficulty remembering three or four passwords, so don't need another one to fool the brain with. Okay, so here is a radio management. This is how it was yesterday. Okay, not much as well, there's nothing that has changed. I took a backup of this, by the way, and the backup is on Google Drive. But anyway, what I want to do now is I want to add this repeater. So to add the repeater to radio management, first thing I need to do is I need to click on the plus sign to add, and then I need to enter the serial number. Serial number I can get from the chassis label, but I want to be lazy and I want to do this. It's going to go into the device monitor or device programmer and just look there. Let me just unplug, and I just need to change that. Okay. Just plug in the repeater again so that I can get it straight away. I don't have to wait all this time. Okay, so there's the serial number there. Copy that. Okay, let's paste it into there. Okay, the rest of the stuff I can leave as is and just say okay. Then to get the configuration from the repeater, I need to right button click, schedule job, read through USB, and I want to generate a configuration, and I want to apply this to the radio. Though this is not a radio, it's a repeater, but you get the idea. Click OK. Now what happens is it device programmer will read the repeater code plug, but through USB. Okay, we don't know anything about the IP addresses and all those kind of things. We just know that there is a repeater and it's connected through USB. So we need to get the configuration data into radio management. We can have a look there, and then we can transfer that information into MNIS. Okay, so it's done. Let me go into the configuration of the repeater. So I click on actions, click on manage, click on configurations. And there you can see is the configuration of the repeater that we've just added. So let's go in, let's edit this configuration. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is I just want to change the name of the configuration. I'm just going to call this repeater one. Okay, if you want, you can put some comments there. Then let's have a look at the network settings. Now, whenever I go from one set to the next, it'll always ask me to save, and I say, yes, I want to save it. I want to update this information. Then let's look at the network settings. So the IP address that is in the repeater now is that 172.16.0.1. This repeater is already set up. I've done all the programming of it some last week. All I'm doing now is I'm just bringing that into radio management. So the repeater is okay, I believe. I just want to go get the information that's in there. So So we know that this repeater has this IP address, 172.16.0.1. You just need to remember that or write it down. Sorry about that. Why am I getting called? Sorry about that. My phone was still running, the phone app that we use. Okay, moving on. The next thing I want to look at is link establishment. Link establishment, these are the settings that relate to IP side connect and capacity plus, etc. So we want this repeater, since it's the only repeater, we want to set this repeater up as the master repeater. Okay, so this is just a, even though this is not an IP side connect system, we still have to set this repeater up as a master repeater and with a static IP address in this case. So if you just have a very simple system with one repeater and radios and you want to do over the air programming, even though that repeater is a standalone repeater, no IP side connect, no capacity plus or whatever, you still have to set that repeater up as a master repeater because MNIS needs something to connect to. It needs to connect to a master repeater. And that repeater, this repeater here, is our master repeater. Then we have the master UDP port and its own UDP port. That's, we'll just leave as standard, but we just need to remember that. 50,000. Okay, there are some things relating to IP side connect. I'm not really interested in those. MOTOTRBO link, phone system sites, that's not relevant. But what is relevant is what we have here in the channel. So we have one channel in this repeater. Let's go in and have a look. So have a channel name, color code is 1. And I've set up this repeater to be IP side connect or a wide area channel on slot 1 and slot 2. So IP side connect is obviously on both slots. It means that you could potentially do over the air programming on both time slot 1 and time slot 2. Receive frequency, transmit frequency, I'm using those. I am allowed to. It's a little bit of a gray area, okay? But for now, I'm just using those frequencies. I am using low power, so I'm not going to, let's say, upset everyone. Long story, but anyway, so that's all good. One of the things I need to just check, just to make sure everything is okay here, but I just want to check one thing, and it you can get caught by this and you will really scratch your head when you do that. When you read a repeater, a brand new repeater, okay, and you read it in, okay, one of the fields you will see is this restricted access to system. We just call it RAS. And when you read the repeater and you look at the configuration, you will see that it comes up with this field here. It says authentication and just says here MVO default value. Now, if you look at it, it doesn't look like you can adjust anything there. It's grayed out. And then, okay, in this case, we can see the number, but you cannot, it will not allow you, you will not see what the REST key is, because the REST key is something which is write only. So you will not see what this key value is, and it will say authentication MVO default value. And then you try to write it to the repeater again, and it will say, oh, you cannot write it because you need to put a REST key in. But I don't want REST. And it's not very clear how to disable REST. What you have to do here is you have to go to this field. You have to say authentication, okay, And you'll see that next to the field, there is this padlock symbol. You click on the padlock, and you can see that the default setting for that was actually enabled. I want it to be disabled. I don't want RAS. Okay. We have enough settings to worry about. We don't need another setting to worry about. So just turn RAS off. Of course, if you want RAS, you can enable it. But okay, I just wanted to point this out because last week I was really scratching my head and I couldn't work out why it didn't want to accept the configuration because, well, I had RAS enabled, but I did not put a key. So the repeater is okay. Okay, and I'm just, to be sure, I'm just going to go put those changes back into the repeater. So a scheduled job right over USB, that's okay. Now, let's look at the server, or at least the PC on which MNIS is running. In this case, I'm running it on the server, but you can also have MNIS running on a separate piece of hardware or a separate virtual machine. So let's go look at MNIS. To set MNIS up, the first thing that you're going to need to do is you need to create a configuration. To do that, you click on this button here, at the top left, new. Okay. In there, we can see, okay, there are some things. The first setting that we come to here, it says system operational mode. If you click on the dropdown, there are different options. So if you're going to be doing a capacity plus or a link capacity plus system, you would select one of those. But in our case, it's just a single repeater, or it could be an IP site connect system. Either way, you would select conventional. The next piece of information that we're asked for is the MNIS application ID. MNIS needs this piece of information. So you need to specify something for this MNIS application ID. Now, what is this? This is the radio ID of MNIS on the radio network. Now, if you remember yesterday, we set up in the radios, we set up ARS. And we said that the radio should send ARS to radio ID 99. Radio ID 99 just so happened to be the radio ID of our control station. Today, we're not going to use the control station. We're going to be using MNIS. And so what we want to have is we want the radios to send their ARS message now to MNIS. Do that, I need to set the MNIS application ID to the same, in this case, as the control station. Okay. Don't worry about the control station. The control station that we were using yesterday, it's turned off and it's unplugged from, okay, the video looks terrible there. MNIS is unplugged from, the control station is unplugged from the PC running MNIS. So we don't need to worry about, let's say, radio ID conflicts or anything like that. So when MNIS is running, eventually, we will get this, what they call the MNIS tunnel IP address. That's that IP address there. Normally, you don't need to change that, but potentially you could have an IP address conflict, in which case you would want to change that. It's up to you, but if you leave it as the default, that's good enough. There are some things relating to security, not interested in that. We're not using any kind of encryption. The group lists, also there's nothing important. I don't need to worry about anything there. That's more related to sending data out or voice out to groups of radios. So there's nothing I need to do there. Private call ranges, I don't need to do anything there. Where I do need to make changes is here under conventional domain or conventional domain one. This is the settings of the repeater network. In this case, just a single repeater in like IP site connect mode. So here I need to give IP address of the master repeater. And this is, you recall, 172.16.0.1. We also need to give the UDP port of the master repeater. We'll use the default 50,000. MNIS link establishment port. Leave that as it is, automatic, that's fine. Single frequency repeater mode, not interested. MOTOTRBO link, not really interested. Do we want to use slot one or slot two for data? Yes, we want to use both. So there are some settings there, but those are not important for us. We want to make sure that the MNIS is using both slot one and slot two. Then moving on, capacity plus, I'm not interested in. Link capacity plus, I'm not interested in. There are some settings here relating to network. My suggestion, leave everything you see here as is. There are some things you may want to change, but in this case, I would suggest not changing anything here unless there is a specific reason for it. Okay, so I would just leave it as it is. I mean, you can change it, but it becomes too complicated, and you need to think a little bit about what you need to do. We need to specify the IP address of our DDMS server, and we have DDMS already installed on this PC. And if you recall yesterday, we said that we put in, that's the IP address of the DDMS server. So 127.0.0.1, it's just saying that it's on the same PC. So let's just minimize that. 127.0.0.1 port 3000. That sounds good. You can have, for example, multiple applications accessing MNIS. So I give you an example. You have a server. On the server, you have two virtual machines. One is for radio management, and the other virtual machine is for Impress fleet management. And you could have even a third machine running a dispatch application. I don't know, smart PTT. Okay. All three of those applications can access the same instance of MNIS. And what you would do here is you would say, okay, any specific port. So for example, port number 4013, that is used by Impress fleet management. So what should happen with that? It should be forwarded, anything coming in on port 4013 should be forwarded to the other VM, the VM which is running Impress fleet management. 4001, I think, is ARS. You want to have ARS being also forwarded to the TurboNet and MNIS. So you would set up a rule there to forward port 4001 to the VM hosting smart PTT or your dispatch application and Impress fleet management and radio management. So you would have like all these rules in there to basically make sure that that information arrives somewhere else other than this PC. There are some settings here, application override. I'm not going to go into that. That just becomes a whole long presentation, very boring. So everything is set up for MNIS. I can now click on save, it asked me to give a name. So I'm just going to call it Group B. Okay. I just click on save. Then I need to go onto configuration. Then I need to go select active configuration. We've just created that one. We say okay. And we can click on start. What that does is when you click on this play button here, it starts MNIS, it starts the service. So now the service is running in Windows. Okay, let's close that. Let's try doing a root print again. Aha, Eureka. So what was missing and what I have here now is I have the list of routes on this PC. So if you look at those three entries here, okay, you can see that now we've added the route to the MNIS gateway. And you will see that there are three IP address ranges. The first one, the 12 IP address range, this is used for the radios themselves. The 13 address range is used for a device connected to the radio through a USB cable or through Bluetooth. So the radio has an IP address, but anything connected to it will also have an IP address made up of this number here plus the radio ID. 14 is the IP address of an option board or a sensor. So anything external will have either 13 or 14. 12 is the radio itself. There is also another route, and that's over here. That is for group data. So if you send a text message from the dispatch application to a group of radios, it will send it to 225 plus the talk group ID. So the groups in MOTOTRBO, their IP address, if you want to call it that, starts with 225. Just remember that you cannot ping a talk group, okay? Because the way the talk group works is that it's a one-way messaging only. That is why we use this address here, this 225 address, which is like a, they call it the class D address, which is reserved for like kind of multicast traffic. But in this case, any IP traffic going to a group, it's one way, because the radios, it doesn't make sense to have, you know, send a message to 1,000 radios and having 1,000 acknowledgements come back. It's completely crazy. Right, so MNIS is running, it's working. Another thing we can go check to make sure that it's working is if we go to the computer and you go to the device manager. So this is like Windows device manager, shows all the things that are connected to the PC. And if we go in and we go to network adapters, one of the things you will see there is this network adapter called the MOTOTRBO tunnel. This is MNIS. So MNIS has created this network connection to which the radios can, or at least to which applications can connect to. Okay, so that looks good. So the issue was something to do with MNIS, with the installation or something like that. I don't know what caused it, but certainly reinstalling cleared the error. So that's okay. Now, the last thing I need to do in order to get, for now I'm okay, but one thing I need to get going in order to, I know, we'll come to that later. Let's first check that, that we can do OTAP. One thing I need to do, and this is in device programmer, is I need to make sure that the device programmer can program radios over the air. It should be there still, but let me just go check. Settings. We're using the PN server, so we're using DDMS. Okay, and you can see there that over the air, it's ticked. Okay, that's good. So I click on OK. There's no changes made, so that's all clear. Now what we can do is we can go do some checks to make sure that we have connectivity to the radios. So I'm going to turn my radios on so that we can eventually ping them. Okay. And what I have to do is on both of my radios, okay, they're already set up, but I need to make sure that it's working. Both of the radios are, I need to make sure that they are on the repeater channel. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, three, four. Okay, so I'm talking now, but I'm going through the repeater. So that's okay. One, two, three, four. So we're talking through the repeater. And so in theory, what I am able to do now is from this PC here, I could ping the radios, but using MNIS. Okay. One thing I want to show you here, just to make sure also we have to do, is we need to be connected to the repeater through IP. So if I go in here and I just type in IP config, I've already done it, but I already have the PC. It has an IP address of 172.16.02. I'm connected to the repeater, but I'm just using a straight Ethernet cable. There is no switch or DHCP or anything like that. So I'm just using my own IP address. And you will recall that we use 172.16.01 on the repeater. Okay. So the first thing that we can actually go do now is we can go see if we have an IP connection to the repeater. So we ping 172.16.01. And there you can see we are able to ping the repeater. So that tells me that I have a connection to the repeater. I can also go ping the MNIS tunnel. So ping 192.168.10.2. Okay. That shows me I have an IP connection to MNIS. So I can talk to MNIS, I can talk to the repeater. All I need now to do is to check if I can ping the radios. So to do that, I type ping 12.0.0.101. This is the IP address of one of the radios. Since we have to be a little bit patient with the radios in terms of ping, I just put a wait time of 5,000 milliseconds. It should be more than enough, but just to make sure that the radio has enough time to answer back, because it's not very fast in terms of ping. So hit the ping. And there you can see we are getting a reply back from the radio. It means that from the radio management server, from the device programmer, and from MNIS, we have IP connectivity. It means that we can now go and try doing over-the-air programming through the repeater using MNIS and using NAI. One thing I forgot to show you in the repeater But it is there, I know that. But one thing you have to check to make sure is to make sure that the repeater has the NAI data license in it. So let me just check that and let me show you that. So that's the repeater there. Okay, and you can see here are all the software licenses that are in this repeater. And if you look here, network application interface data, it shows purchased. So this repeater has got NAI data enabled in it. So it's all good. Okay. So what we can do now is we can go try out over the air programming. So I'm going to go to my two radios again here, and I'm going to make some small change in it, like we done yesterday. So I just go to manage, and I go to configurations, and I go into the configuration that is used by those radios. So I click on edit, and I'm going to go in, and I'm going to pick something here, some arbitrary setting. Let's go back to that button. Okay, and you remember that we made the side button 2 to radio name. Let's change that to something that's not too fancy. Turn the microphone AGC on and off, okay? Just for the hell of it, okay? So now I'm going to change the function of side button 2, okay? So I just click on save to save those changes. Then if I go back to radio view now, both of those radios have got this purple dot here showing that there was some changes to the code plug, okay? So I have those two radios now, they're selected. I can go schedule job, and now I can select right. And instead of over USB or Wi-Fi, I select over the air. Click okay. And now the job will start. So it'll start constructing the code plug, the changes at least to the code plug, and it will communicate with the device programmer. The device programmer will send the data to MNIS. MNIS will send it to the repeater, and the repeater will send it to the radios. So I have the device programmer, at least the device monitor, open here on the server. And so any second now, it should start getting the jobs. It will talk to the radios, and it will start writing the radio. So there's the first one there in. Now it will start talking to the radio. I just have to make sure that the radios are sitting next to each other here. Okay, so it's doing that one already. So it's busy talking to the radios. And as soon as it's done, as soon as it's doing its handshake, it will write like you can see here now. As I said, the good thing with over-the-air programming is that if you make a change in the radio configuration, over-the-air programming only sends the update. It doesn't send the entire code plug. So it's relatively light in terms of the amount of data that needs to be sent over the air. Yes, it takes some time, but there is a lot of handshaking that needs to happen to make sure that the radio gets the correct information and there are no errors in the received data. So that radio is now done. It now will start with the new configuration in it. And you can see here that the device programmer has got the green tick next to it. And if we go to radio management client, you can see that this radio here it's showing as completed. The other radio here, as soon as that one starts, and as soon as it boots up again, it will also show as completed. So over-the-air programming is something that you would want to schedule for off-peak periods. So when you schedule a job, for example, let me just show you something. I'll just do this radio here. Okay. When you schedule a job, you can also, you can specify at what time this job should start and at what time this job should finish. And this can be both in terms of time, hours, as well as days. So you can say, okay, I want to update the configuration in these radios, and I only want to start on, I don't know, Saturday night, because maybe this particular customer, they're not working on Saturdays. So you can select, okay, I want to do the over-the-air programming, I want to do the updates, but I only want this to happen on a certain day at a certain time. So when it's off-peak periods, when the system is not so busy. And that's the best time to do over-the-air programming. So you can basically, you know, set up a whole bunch of radios in a relatively short amount of time without disturbing any radio communication traffic. Okay, so there you can see the both radios are now done. We're able to program both radios successfully over the air using OTAP, MNIS, and NAI in the repeater. So I'm going to go into radio management, and you will recall that yesterday we had our repeater here running, and we were using it for IP remote programming. So there's the repeater over there. Let me just move the camera a wee bit over that you can see it. Okay. So there's the repeater there. You can see that the blue cable at the bottom there, that's the Ethernet cable coming off of it. I still have the programming cable plugged in, but I can remove that anyway. I just kept it in there. And then the other cable that you see coming in here, that's the DC power. Just off the screen there, that's a dummy load. And then this is the receive antenna. I just have it plugged in through an attenuator just to like kind of limit the range. I found I needed to have an antenna here, because without an antenna, the shielding on the repeater is so good that, you know, if you go more than a few meters away, then you start running into problems. So I'm just going to go log into radio management here. I had closed it. So I'm just going to go log in again. Just remove the password. Okay, as soon as it loads. All right. So there you can see is our repeater. And now what I want to do is I want to set up this repeater for IP remote programming. So there are some settings I need to do. Most of them are actually in the device programmer and on the PC. But there is one setting in the repeater which I need to go and check. So to do this, I need to go to that repeater and right button click on its entry and select edit configuration. You can also go from, you know, at the little green block at the top here, actions, manage configurations. That's also, it has the same, it brings you to the same location. So this is the configuration of that repeater. And I'm going to go down here under, I think it is under network. Yeah, It's under network. So it's already ticked, but there is this one setting here, IP repeater programming. So this is the ability to basically program the repeater through IP. And you can see there that there is already a tick there to say that it's enabled. So there is in the repeater actually nothing that we need to change. It looks like when I read it, it was already in there. So I will leave it in there. That's fine. Just a reminder from yesterday, we spoke about IP addresses. We said that that the repeater, it's a set up as a master repeater. And we said that this is its IP address. So we just need to kind of remember that, because we will come back to that in a short while. So there is nothing I need to change here. The repeater is ready to be programmed through IP. But there are some things I need to change in radio management. What I need to do is I need to tell the device programmer and I need to tell radio management how it should connect to this repeater. And to do that, I need to go here. I click on Actions. I click on Manage. And I go to IP System Settings. So at the moment, you can see that there is nothing there. What I need to do is I need to click on the plus button here to add something. And now radio management asks me, what do I want to add? What type of system is this? Well, is it a capacity max system? Is it a capacity max repeater? No, it is a link establishment repeater. Link establishment repeater means it's a repeater that is either running in capacity plus or IP side connect mode, or in this case, standalone mode with an IP connection back to MNIS. So we need to select a link establishment repeater. Then we give it a name. So I will just call this workshop one, let's say. Then we are asked for either the host name or the IP address of the master. So in this case, I'm putting in the IP address of the master and the port number that it should connect to the master on. So the, let's say this master UDP port. If you're using any authentication, you would put it in there. That's for the authentication between master and peer. So there would be like a authentication key. In this case, I'm not using anything, so I can just leave that blank and I click OK. Okay. Then I go back to Radio View and I go to the repeater that I want to have IP remote programmed, and I right button click on it and I say select IP system settings. What that does is it says, okay, to access this repeater, use these IP system settings. And you can see there is the one that I've just created. I say, okay, I select it and I say, okay. And then now that is applied. And you can see that it now appears under this column here, IP system settings. So this repeater now uses those IP system settings. The next thing we need to do is we need to make sure that the device programmer will talk to the repeater using IP remote programming. Now, I need to come back to my diagram. Let me come back to the diagram that I showed you on day one. Here is it here. So if you look here, the repeater is connected to our radio management server. Okay, in this case, we're connecting into MNIS for over-the-air programming, but the IP connection between the repeater and the server, it's through Ethernet. Okay, so let me try to show you that. It's a little bit difficult with the camera view angle will be a little bit bad, but if you see, if you look here, there is the Ethernet cable coming out of my out of my repeater, the blue Ethernet cable, and then it goes all over the desk here. It's a little bit muddled. There you can see it's going across over there, around around the backs of the monitor, and then behind the coffee cup, and it's plugged in over there on this laptop here, which is my radio management server. So it's just a straight Ethernet connection. Okay. Now, when I do that, of course, I don't have anything else connected to the network. So I need to do some things on that PC to obviously connect, to have IP connectivity. So one of those is, of course, is to have a static IP address. So if I just go to my network settings, okay, this is, for most of you, I think should be pretty easy. It should be pretty standard things. So let me just get to the, I have an app that does this normally, but anyway, network and sharing, that's the one I was looking for. Okay, so that's MNIS. This should be our repeater. So if I click on that, click on Ethernet, and I just click on details, what I've done is I've set this PC up with a static IP address of 172.16.02. So this is this PC's IP address. And I just put in the gateway, which was the repeater. Okay. So there is a connection between the two. What the repeater's dot one and the PC is dot two. So I can actually go and, if I wanted to, I can go and ping the repeater IP address. The other thing that I need to do on this PC is I need to set up the device programmer to be able to talk to the repeater using IP remote programming. And to do that, I need to go into the device programmer, go to this device monitor, which is like the kind of the graphical user interface, if you want to call it that, and I can go into settings. Then in settings, I need to click here. You'll see that there is this tick box here, IP program. And then when I click on it, what it will do is it brings up a bunch of new settings here. My suggestion is, leave these as they are. If you want to change them, you can change them, but just be very careful what you change, because changing something here may affect the something else in somewhere in the repeater or in the network. So just be a little bit careful. So basically, when you do IP remote programming to the repeater, you actually use TCP. And there are a block of TCP ports that radio management, or at least the device programmer, will use to communicate to the repeater. These TCP ports lie between 50,000 and 50,100. On a straight piece of cable, that's no big deal. But just remember that if you're going to have, for example, a multi-site capacity plus network or IP site connect network, where repeaters are sitting behind a router or even a firewall, that those ports need to be allowed to pass. Okay, so that port range needs to be allowed to pass to the repeater. And also, if you're going to be using a router, the router needs to be set up to forward that traffic to the repeater. Okay. Then there is a UDP port that is also used. This is like a kind of a control port. I'm not exactly sure what it does. I haven't, let's say, studied what's happening on that port number. But my suggestion here is also just to leave it as it is and just make sure that the firewall or router is set up to pass that to the correct IP address. You can specify an ID, let's say a radio ID of the device programmer. This is like a kind of a radio ID, but it's also a device ID on the IP network. So here again, I would suggest to leave this as it is. You can change it, but yeah, it becomes a little bit dangerous, let's say. There is one sitting here, a device programmer, device ID, but this is related to capacity max. So we're not going to do that. That's a different kettle of fish, let's say. So those are all the settings that you need to just check to be that need to be in the device programmer. Because I've made a change, when I click OK, it will say it needs to restart. So it will restart device programmer, and now that's done. When you've selected this IP remote programming, you will see that this block here is added. This is basically just like a kind of a status information to know whether radio management is or device programmer is talking to a repeater. So at the moment, nothing is happening, so it can, let's say, stay as it is. That's fine. But when we program the repeater, when we make a change in the repeater configuration and write this over IP, you will see that there is something comes up there. The last thing that we need to take care of, and it's already been done, but in this case, we need to take care of this, is because this radio management server, this laptop here next to me, is running Windows 10. Windows 10 comes with a piece of software called Windows Defender Firewall. It's a built-in application. It's very good for, let's say, you know, browsing the internet, you know, this kind of stuff. But when it comes to doing, let's say, unusual stuff like remotely programming repeaters, it can cause problems for us. And so one of the things you need to do is those ports that you saw in device programmer, basically these ports here plus some others, you need to make sure that those are unblocked on Windows Defender Firewall. And to do that, you need to go and create some rules. I'm not going to go into it. If you're interested, you can send me an email and I can explain to you how it's done. But basically, you have to create some inbound rules and outbound rules to pass, to allow those ports to pass. Now, I've created one already, and I could just show you that. I think you can edit this. Okay, so basically what we're doing is we allow the connection and we allow a TCP port 50,000 to 50,100. So those are that's the settings that you need to put into this Windows firewall. Otherwise, what will happen is the firewall will block it and you'll find that you cannot program the repeater, even though everything else is set up correctly. What I find that helps, if you want to, let's say, check whether this Windows firewall is creating this problem for you, is actually just to go temporarily disable it. If you can do whatever you need to do while Windows Defender Firewall is disabled, then you know it's something in there, some setting in this firewall that's blocking whatever. So enough talking. So there, the repeater is now set up to be IP remote programmed. We can do some simple checks. I mean, you can do some simple diagnostic checks. For example, we can see that we can ping the repeater. We know that. I know it will ping, but we can check it. So pinging the repeater works. That means the IP connection to the repeater is okay. So that's good. Now what we can do is to go try it out. We can go into radio management and we can go to the repeater and we can make some change in the repeater, some arbitrary change that's not going to affect too much. So I just go into the repeater and I'm just going to change something. Okay. What I'll do is I'll change one of the accessory pins. Okay. Let's have a look here. This one here, GPIO7. And I'm going to change it's currently set as unassigned. And I'm just going to change it to say a major alarm. So if there is an alarm on the repeater, then this pin GPIO7, whichever pin it is on the accessory connector, will go high, basically. So we can click on save to commit that change. And we go back to radio view. You will see here now that there is this purple block here next to that repeater, which tells me I can now write this information to the repeater. Now, just to show you that I'm not playing tricks on you or anything like that, here's the programming cable for the repeater. You can see that it's unplugged. So I'm gonna program the repeater, but it's gonna happen through IP. Now, there is no flashing lights or anything like that to show that the repeater is doing something. All we can do is we can go here into radio management client and right button click on the repeater, schedule job, and we say write. And instead of selecting USB, we say IP program. What that does is now it will, when we click OK, it will start the write job. And it will go in. Okay, so let's click OK. And you can see it's processing job. If I go look quickly to the server, now it will try to connect to the master. There you can see it's done that. Now it's writing. It's finished. I don't know if the repeater does I think it might do a soft reset, I'm not sure. Once that's done, it disconnects from the repeater. And if we go back to radio management here, you can see now that we've written the repeater, the job status shows as completed. And you can see that the purple dot has now disappeared. So that's the repeater. So now we can program a repeater through the IP connection. Cool. Any questions so far on what you've just seen? I'm just checking the Q&A, nothing in Q&A, nothing in chat so far. So far, so good. I hope that was clear enough for all of you. If you're still unsure, you're welcome to just ask a question via chat. Or if you don't want to ask a question here, you can always send me an email. I'll put my contact details up at the end of the session today. So the next thing that I want to do is I want to add a bunch of radios. So on my desk here, you can see all the radios. These are the two radios that we've been working with so far, these two radios here. And you can see that lighting is not so good, but these are DP4801Es. So those are the two that we've done so far, radio 101, 102. Now, what I want to do is I want to add these two radios here. Nice new radios. They even still got the sticker, the lens protector on display. But if you look at these radios here, I don't know if you can make that out, but you can see that those there are DP4800Es. So these are like the non-GPS model radio. Focus, there you are. Okay, so this is, so they're both DP4800Es. I want to add those two. And then I've got here, this is the only one I have, as you can see, DP4401E. So I want to put all of these radios, these three additional radios, onto our radio system. And so the procedure to do that is exactly like we've done so far. First, we need to read the radio using a cable. Then we need to apply all the settings that we want to these radios. Okay, I'll show you how we can get the data from one to the other. And then we need to write them again using the cable so that basically they can get all the latest configuration. And then once we've done that, then they should be able, well, they firstly will be able to talk to these radios here, these ones that we've been using so far. And they can also be programmed over the air using MNIS. And then, we can have a look there. So let me go into radio management here. I'm going to connect the first radio up, and it's going to be the DP4800. Okay, let's plug it in. Power the radio on. Now, I need to get the serial number of the radio, and the battery is flat. Okay, let me change the battery quickly. Yes, I did unplug it. And let me see if I can, should charge this battery. Okay, I'll put that one aside, get a new one now. Okay, that one's a bit better. Right, so I'm going to read this radio, and I need to get the serial number. So, of course, you can copy it down from wherever. I'll show you tomorrow how we can add serial numbers, let's say, automatically. But I want to do it a little bit of a lazy way of doing it, and I'm going to try get it from device programmer. So let me just refresh it. There is it there. So this is my lazy way of getting the serial number, is just to grab it from device programmer. So like you saw on day one, we just add the serial number. The rest of the stuff you can leave out. We say okay. Then right button click, schedule job, read. And now, since this is a different model of radio, I want to get the configuration from that radio. So generate configuration, and we may as well apply it to the radio. We hit okay. Okay, so now what's happening is that radio management is reading this radio through USB. It's creating a configuration and applying that configuration to the radio. So you'll see when it's finished, you get the serial number. Oh, okay, this one's already been done. But anyway, so there I have the radio serial number. There is the name of its configuration. And you can see there are some other details there that have been read. Okay, so that radio is done. Now what I want to do is I want to do the next guy. So I'm going to, well, this radio, this the other radio is also a DP4800E. So what the question you need to ask, or I need to ask myself, is do I really need to read this radio and generate a configuration? The answer is no. Why? Because we already have a configuration. We already have an MVO. So we can just reuse that on this radio here. All I need is the radio serial number. And to get that, I just can just go into the device programmer. Let me just get it to get the serial number, the lazy way of doing it. So there is it there. Let's just copy that over. Let's add the serial number. That's all I need to do from this radio. Okay, what I can do now is I can say, okay, well, I want to apply the MVO and all that, but let's first go back and do something on the radio that we've just read, the one we've done before. So I want to change the name of this configuration. I can edit it here if I want to. I can call this, I can give it a name here, I believe. But what I like to do is I like to go to Manage, Configurations, and I can go into here and I can start setting, well, let's say put all the settings into this configuration that I want. So I just select that configuration, I click on Edit, and it now opens up the configuration for that radio. You can see that this is all pretty straightforward CPS stuff, so all the settings of the radio. And I can change here, for example, the name. I'll just call it the config DP4800E1. There are some things. These are all just the standard standard kind of stuff that you would want to put in there. I want to add contacts. So I just, okay, it's already there, but I'm just going to delete for now. I'm just going to delete those. Okay. Let me just delete it just so I can show you what I'm going to do. Okay. Now, so by default, this is how the contacts on the radio would look if it's a new radio. Okay, you will just have one entry, one default entry in there. I want to get the contact lists, but I don't want to have to type out all the contacts again. I want to get the contact list from one of the radios that we programmed yesterday and the day before and all that. So what we can do here is if we go to the contacts, so we go here and you go right button click and you say copy set from. Okay, so you say copy set from, and here it gives you the option of copying the contacts from another configuration. So I'm going to select the configuration that we've done for the other two radios, okay, the radio 101 and 102. And I'm going to say OK. And there you can see are all the contacts in these other radios. Now, there's only two, but you could have 1,000 in there. And you could actually now copy all of those contacts over from one radio to the other. So you can just go OK. And now those contacts have been added. Don't need to type anything or anything like that. It's already done. And in fact, this applies to any of the other things here. So the receive group list, you can copy those too over. So I can go there and I say Oops, sorry, no, there's nothing in there to copy. Okay. The other thing that you can do is you can copy channels over. So I think this one is already set up. Okay, I just need to go. Well, let's see if we can do it. Let's say copy set from. Okay, so I can copy even the channels over from the other two radios. There's the zone there that was in those radios. And then it's now added. So now you have this zone one. Let me just delete these, delete zone four. Okay, so the radio only has the one zone in there. A frequently asked question is what is this CB zone? The CB zone is like a piece of data that's somehow left in the radios. Basically, these radios are sold in Australia as CB radios. There is like in most countries, I don't know about every single country, but a lot of our countries, yeah, a lot of your countries that I see there, we have obviously citizen band, which is 27 megahertz. Okay. It's quite popular in many countries. This is like a very easily licensed or license-free frequency band, and that's fine. But in Australia, and I think also New Zealand, their citizen band is in this frequency range. There's 467 megahertz. And so we actually sell these radios, MOTOTRBO radios, as analog-only radios operating in this citizen band, this Australian citizen band. There are the frequencies over there. And somehow this configuration data is left in there. You can actually go in and you can actually delete this CB zone, I believe. So I'm just going to take it out because who needs it? we just need our radio, our channels, which we are licensed for. So all of these things you can copy between configuration. So if you have now a different model, you don't have to recreate everything. You can simply copy those sets from one configuration to the other. Okay. So I've done the contacts. The only thing I just want to do is the group list. Yeah, I cannot copy it across. Okay. Okay, that's fine. I'll leave that as it is. Okay. Now, what I can do is you can see that I've made some changes to the configuration of this radio because the little purple dot has now come up. So I need to obviously then write this back to the radio. But before I do that, I just want to check something. So first thing I want to check is this radio alias. Is this correct? Yes, it's that's what I want to have. And then is the radio ID correct? Yes, it is. That's fine. All those other things. Okay, that all seems to be okay. But before I write this radio again, I want to, it's always a good idea to run analyze. So you go to the radio, the right button click, and you select analyze. What radio management does now is it'll go through and it will do like a parse. It will check, are there any mistakes in this radio? Did I miss anything? So if I go click on the results, okay, it's showing green. So that shows that it's okay. Now let's go do this radio. Now that I've set this radio up and it's okay, let's go do the next radio. So the next radio, do I need to go and program anything? Do I need to go set up anything? Not really. What I can do is I can go right button click and I can say, okay, I want to select a schedule job. I want to select a configuration, but it's grayed out. In order to select a configuration, I first need to select an MVO, because radio management only knows a serial number. It doesn't know what type of radio it is. So we have to select an MVO to tell radio management what radio this is. So if I go here, here is the model number that I want, this H56RDN. This is a DP4800 model number. So I click OK. So now it has the same model number as the other radio. But what it does is it also gives it the same radio alias and that. So I want to change that. I want to make this one, say, radio 104. Okay, that's fine. It also copies the radio ID. It kicks that up. Then what else? That's all good. Okay. Now what we can do is we can also now say select configuration, and I want to make it, give it this configuration here, config 4800E blah, blah, blah. This is the one that we've just worked on, the one that you saw that I copied the sets to and all that. So that's done. Now I can click OK. So now what happens is it applies the configuration from that was used on this radio on this radio. So they should be now set up the same, only difference being is the radio alias. So let's go put this information back into those radios. So I select the two radios that I've just added, and I say right button click, and I say schedule job right over USB, because we cannot do OTAP it. Okay, that's, I still need to go check that, but let's see. So we write that those radios back over USB. Click OK. And now as soon as the device programmer sees the radio, that radio will be written. It takes a few seconds for it to build the job. So this one is being written now. Okay, so that's done. We should start up with a new configuration. Let's do the other radio. Okay, and now that should get programmed. Okay, so that's done. Okay, and if I just do a radio check, comms check here to make sure that they are able to talk to one another happily. One, two, three. Okay, so they're able to talk to one another. The only thing that I didn't do, and I just need to go check, is whether these two newly added radios can be programmed over the air. But to do that, I think is a pretty simple exercise. You just need to go in and change the settings relating to OTAP. Okay, so those are those two added. Now I want to add, I'm just gonna steal this one's battery. These all flat. Let's steal this guy's battery. Now I'm gonna do the 4401E, so the non-display GPS model. Right, so let's connect him up. Okay, now since this is a new model, that's ready, let's say new model, since it's a a model that has not been seen in radio management before. In this our installation here, I need to read the radio, but I also now need to generate the configuration. So let me get the serial number first. Just speeded things up a little bit. Okay, so there's the serial number there. Let's go grab it. So that's the serial number. Let's go add the serial number. Say okay. Right button click, schedule job, read through USB, generator configuration, so forth. And we just say okay. So it's going to read this radio, it's going to generate the configuration, it's going to apply it to the radio. Okay, so it's done. We have the radio alias there. Let's just change that. Let's go make it radio 105 and give it its ID. Ooh, that's an unusual one. 105. Okay, and it's that one. That's all good. So I want to go in and do some configuration changes in the config. So manage configurations. There's the one that we've just added there now. I go in, I edit, and I'm just going to give it a name. All of that. Then let's go through all the things. So I just want to get the contacts over, so I can go again here, right button click, copy set from, just take those two, add those. So we add the contacts to the radio. Then I want to go into the channels and I want to say, let's get channels from the other radios. So copy set from, let's say DP4801E, I believe, I think it's this one here. Let's go try that. Yeah, that's it. It's got two digital channels in. Okay. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to delete this zone one because I don't want to have to go and toggle between zones on this radio. So let's just get rid of those ones. We're only going to use this zone. Okay, I've deleted some stuff, so I need to go check to make sure that it's done right. What I want to do is I just want to go in and go edit the... do I really need to do that? Yeah, okay. I just save it as it is. Okay. Let's just go back to radio view. You can see now that this radio, the configuration has changed. Ah, I forgot to do that. Let me just go quickly one thing. I forgot to do that. Let's just go quickly to that radio once more. Before I write it, and I need to go here to general under network, and I just want to make sure, yeah, that's what I need to do. I want to set it up for OTAP, so I'm just going to put in the ARS radio ID. I think it was 99. Yeah. And I want to also just check that we can do over-the-air programming. That's under security. Down here, over-the-air programming. Yeah, so the key is there. That's good. Let's just go into the channels and just see that that it's got ARS enabled. Just go into that one. Yeah, it's enabled. Okay, so that's good. So let's go back to radio view now. And I want to write this code plug back to the radio. But before I do that, let's go do right button click and analyze. Done. Ah, good. Okay, so you can see that I deleted some stuff and I made a mistake. I deleted some things, but I left some other things there. So you can see that it found one mistake, and it says here on this radio, on a scan list, the selected set no longer exists. So it's saying that I deleted some channels, but those channels were referred to in the scan list. So I need to go fix that. Now I can always go back and go into the configuration, all that stuff. But what I can do is I can just simply double click on this line. And what radio management will do is it will take me straight to the place where the problem is. So you can see there that there is something there that's no longer there. So I need to fix it. So I just go say, oh, okay. It's a scan list. The radio is scanning something. So I can just remove that. I can just go click on remove. That should clear the problem. So I just save that. Let's go back to radio view again, just to make 100% sure. Right button click again on the radio that we're going to do and analyze. And now what it will do is it'll do the analysis again, go through, check if there are any mistakes. And now you can see it's come up green. So now we can write this radio and the radio should work correctly. So let's go do right button click, schedule job. Now, because we've not set the radio up on the system yet, we have to write back using USB. So I do that, click OK, and it will get written over USB, and it will start up again with the new configuration. To upgrade a radio in radio management, you'll first need to install the upgrade package. This is the regular upgrade package used to upgrade radios with CPS. Now, once installed, you'll need to import the upgrade package into radio management. To do this, go to Actions, Manage Firmware, and then click on the dot, dot, dot button and choose Import. Select the upgrade packages you want to import and click OK. The selected upgrade packages will now be imported. My recommendation here is to install the upgrade package on the server and import the packages from an RM client installed on that server. You can do this from a remote RM client, but the package needs to then be copied across the network. Also remember that importing lots of upgrade packages will increase the size of the RM database. So plan for extra disk drive or remove the upgrade packages you don't need anymore. Once imported, you'll see the upgrade packages here. In RadioView, right button click on the radio or radios you want to upgrade and select upgrade firmware. In some cases, like here, you might have to also upgrade the language pack. Once complete, you can then right button click on the radio and select schedule job and write via USB. In this case, I wasn't able to schedule the job until the language pack was also upgraded. You'll notice that the modified column for that radio has the purple, green, and pink dots. The purple is there because I also made a configuration change in this radio. So firmware, language pack, and code plug will be written in one go. The radio will now be upgraded. Note that you can only upgrade a radio via USB or Wi-Fi. Repeaters can be upgraded by USB or over IP. The time needed to upgrade is hardware dependent. While this happens, you can go and get a suitable beverage and watch the progress bar as the device programmer does its magic. Once complete, the radio will restart with the new firmware, configuration, and language pack. Okay, so that was upgrading firmware in the radios. So it's a relatively simple process. It takes a while. In that video where you heard the music playing, I sped that up by, I think, like three times. Otherwise, you know, watching the progress bar can be a little bit boring, I guess. So the next thing that I want to talk to you about this morning is offline programming. So one of the possibilities we have in radio management is the ability to program radios that are not don't have a, let's say, IP connection or a physical connection back to the radio management server. So these could be radios in a remote location, or radios that cannot be programmed over the air, whatever. There is a possibility to basically program these radios in, let's say, offline mode. So how does this work? Well, just a very simple setup here. In order to do offline programming, or the way that it works is, what you would have is you would have your radio management server, and you would have a PC that is connected to the server, which we would call the online device programmer. This PC or laptop, or whatever it could be, you would connect to the radio management server. You would do what it is, whatever it is that you need to do in the radios, programming wise. And on this PC, you would plug in your USB stick. The size of the USB stick would be determined by how many radios you want to do offline programming on. So basically what would happen here is that you would set this up to be like a kind of to prepare offline jobs. And basically what would happen is when you schedule the job, instead of trying to write the radio, what would happen is that you would create a zip file. And this zip file you would save on your memory stick. And once all of the jobs are saved on this memory stick, you would take the memory stick with you together with a laptop computer. On this laptop computer would be installed the device programmer, just the device programmer, nothing else. And you would have your programming cables with you. So you'd arrive at site, you'd find the radios, you'd bring them in, and you'd connect them to the PC, and you'd put the USB stick in, you'd import the jobs, and as soon as the radio is connected, it would start writing. Okay, so to do this in radio management, we need to do some things. Let me minimize that. Okay, so this is my desktop, my computer's desktop, and I'm going to go into my device programmer. Okay, and I'm going to go into settings. And in the device programmer settings, there is, you will see a button at the bottom here called Work Offline. If I click on Work Offline, what happens is that the device programmer will no longer connect to the server. Okay, so this device programmer is offline. So it's not connecting to the server anymore. Then what I would need to do is on my, let's say, online device programmer, I would need to go and prepare some jobs. So I'm just going to go into this online device programmer. So there you can see it there. It's connected to the radio management server. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into radio management. And I'm going to make some changes in the radios that we were working with yesterday. So the two DP4801Es, these two radios here. So I'm going to program them, but I'm going to program them in offline mode. Okay, so we're in radio management now. There are my two radios. Okay, and what I want to do is I want to just make some change just so that we can get the purple dot again, allowing radio management to say that there was a change made and allowing us to write this change back to the radio. So I'm just going to go into manage configurations. I'm going to go to the configuration that is used by those two radios there. And I'm going to change something. Let's go add a contact. So we just go create new set. Okay, it could be anything. I mean, you could add another channel. It's up to you. So let's just call that one talk group 3. And we're going to give it a group call, and it's call ideas 3. Save. Okay, so I've added the talk group to that configuration. And now if we go back to radio view, you can see that those two radios there have got the purple dot next to them. Now, what I need to do now is I need to go schedule a job. So I need to schedule job, and I need to write, and I need to go through a USB, okay? So the normal way you would write a job through a wired connection, and then we would click OK. Okay, so now it's preparing the job, it's preparing the thing to be written. And now I need to go into my online device programmer. So the device programmer, which is connected to the radio management server. And I need to go into settings. And then I scroll down here to that's because I have not. I think I got to do that. Yeah. Sorry. One of the things you have to be careful of is that the device programmer, the online device programmer, shall only have USB ticked. If you try to tick the other things, it won't work. Okay. Now that I've unticked that, I have this button here, status. So if I go to status, you can see that there are two jobs pending. These are the jobs that I can now export. So I go to those two jobs and I say, okay, those are the two jobs that I want to send to the radio. So I'm going to plug in my memory stick here. There's the memory stick in. And I'm going to, I think you can just download. Let's see. No, export, sorry. Export. And then you browse to where you want to export this file to. So I'm just going to put it on my memory stick. So that's my memory stick there. It's called Wayne, so I know that it's mine. And I'm just going to call it jobs. Oops, spelling is not good this morning. Jobs. Okay. So what it does is it creates this zip file with the jobs in. I click on save. If you want, you can put in a password. I'm not really interested in that. You just click OK. And now if I go, okay, it shows export successfully completed. And if I go to my memory stick, you will see that there is a zip file there containing the files that I would need to bring to the offline device programmer. So let me unplug the memory stick and come back to the offline device programmer. Just need to find a USB slot here that I can plug into. That's the problem with modern laptops. They don't come with many. Okay, I'm just going to steal that. Okay. I just unplugged something here. So I've plugged in my memory stick into the computer. We're looking at my desktop computer now. This is the offline device programmer. So now I want to get, I've got the memory stick plugged in on my desktop, on my PC. I want to bring these files that I've, this job zip file, I want to bring it in here. So what I do is I click on here, status. And I click on this button here at the bottom, import. And I go to the file that is on the stick. So there's it there. There's that jobs.zip file that we created a moment ago. If you have to, you can put in a password. Otherwise, you just click OK. So now the right job has been imported into the onto this PC. And now all I need to do is to plug in the radios one by one. onto the PC. And as soon as the device programmer sees that radio will get written. So there's the one. Just remember that there is no, this device programmer here is not connected to the radio management server. So although you can see it on your desktop because I'm connected to the internet, this device programmer is not talking to the radio management server. So this laptop could be anywhere. It could be in the middle of nowhere. And you would be able to program radios from radio management. Now, with radio management in offline mode, there is no real way for radio management to know whether the radio was successfully programmed. The device programmer here does not write anything to the zip file. It just reads the zip file, and that's it. So once you've exported the files in on the online device programmer, it will show as complete in radio management. So the next thing that I wanted to talk to you about is activating licenses in radio management. So I guess you've all done license activation in CPS. License activation in radio management is it's similar, but there are some differences. So let's go through it step by step, and then we can see how it works. So the first thing I'm just going to do is I'm just going to go back into my offline device program and just make it online again so that we can do the license activation while it's connected. Although you could, I believe, do the license activation while it's offline. There's no big difference, but I'm just going to do it online. It goes quicker and easier. So that's connected, that's fine. Let's go into radio management. And I want to go to click on actions. And I want to click on manage. And I want to click on licenses. And then go to radio licenses. So here it gives me a list of all the radios, what features are enabled in each radio. That's all nice, but I want to add a feature to a radio. So I'm going to go, and I need to go click on add, so plus add sign. Now it asks me to, you'll see at the top here, enter the EID, the entitlement ID. So I got one yesterday. There's the entitlement ID. So I just put that into the field here, and I click on query. Okay. Oh, there is one radio here which I can do. Okay, 807 TSB. Okay, we'll do this radio. So you can see that I have an entitlement ID. This is my entitlement ID. And the feature that is on there is Wi-Fi subscriber, so Wi-Fi license. And I have available 5, and I've purchased 5. So that means it's a brand new entitlement ID with 5 licenses on it that can be used wherever, okay? Then at the bottom here on the left, it gives me the radios which can have Wi-Fi enabled on them. So lucky for me, the DP4800 that we used, oh no, it's not, the DP4401E that we used yesterday, this does not have Wi-Fi enabled on it yet. So I can put Wi-Fi onto this radio, which is great for us. So there's the radio that can have Wi-Fi enabled. If you had multiple radios, they would be all listed here. And then what you would do is you would select the radios which you want to update, or you would select the radios which you want to activate this feature on. I only have one radio here, so I just click on add. So I've added the radio. Okay. And now what I need to do is I need to click on register. When I click on register, radio management is going to go off to the internet and it's connected to the Motorola server that handles the licenses and says, is this entitlement ID valid? Yes, if it is, take this serial number and associate it with that entitlement ID. I click on register. And now what it does is it, let's say, ties that serial number to that feature. So if I had to go look again, if I had to go check that EID again and I take query, okay, you will see that there's entitlement ID available now is changed to 4 and purchased is obviously still 5. So it says to me now that it's deducted one license from this entitlement ID and this is now available for the radio. If I go back to radio view and I go to that radio there, there's the radio there, you can see that this block here, I don't know what color that is, like a kind of a beige color. And if you hover over it, it comes up with like this beige and it says here, features ready for activation. It means that there is a software feature that is available for this radio. At the same time, since I've enabled a Wi-Fi, there are some settings that changed. So basically what it's done is it's gone added some fields related to Wi-Fi into the configuration for this radio. So not only is the beige dot on, the purple dot is also on, telling me that the code plug has been modified. So I need to go to this radio, right button click, says schedule job, and click on right. And I'm just going to do it through USB. You can do it over the air. There's nothing stopping you from doing that. But I'm just going to do it through USB. And I click OK. Now what I need to do is I need to go get the radio. One second. Here he is. Okay, so let me attach the programming cable. So it's done. So the radio now will start up again and it will have some features related to Wi-Fi enabled. Okay. Then if you go to this radio now and you go right button click and you say show details and you go to feature sets. If you look here under Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi is now showing as purchased. It means that I've bought that software license and it's now enabled in the radio. Any questions on that? All good? Okay. So the next thing that we can do is we can look at how we can import serial numbers and code plugs into radio management. So let me go back to radio view. So we've seen that we can add radios by reading them through USB. We also have the possibility to import code plugs. So I give you a practical example. Let's say you look after a customer, and this company has bought another company, okay, and they have also MOTOTRBO radios, and company A is using radio management to manage their configurations, or at least you are, and company B has got MOTOTRBO radios, but whoever programmed them, they just set them up using CPS. So now company A and B want to merge, and they want to merge their database. So what you can do is you can read the radios from company B, save the code plugs or get hold of the code plugs, and import this into radio management. It's pretty easy to do. You go to radio view here. You click on this dot, dot, dot button. You select import. And then you go find a code plug. I'm going to just go to the CPS folder. It should be here. Yeah, MOTOTRBO CPS. And go to samples, go to EMEA. I'll just import this radio here. Now, when you click on import, you will ask you, do you want to create a configuration? Or do you want to add the radio, and do you want to apply the configuration to the radio, just like we do when we read the radio through USB? You click on import, and what it will do is it will read the code plug and create a configuration and create an entry in radio view matching that radio. So there's the radio there that we've just added. You can also import code plugs that were created in the old version of CPS, so the .ctb files. Let me go open one. So the old MOTOTRBO file. So let's pick one here. So same thing, import, and it's done. You can also transfer, let's say, individual radios from one instance of radio management to the other. To do that, you just select the radio that you are interested in. So let's take this one here, and we say right button click, and you say export, and you select radio. What this does is it creates a file known as a code plug byte array, XPBA. This XPBA file can be imported easily from one instance of radio management to the other. So you can actually transfer individual radios between different radio management databases or different instances of radio management. And this applies to radios and repeaters. A third possibility, and I have to try this out, because sometimes it doesn't work because I mess up some things, but a third possibility is to import serial numbers from a spreadsheet. Now, to get an idea of how the spreadsheet should look, you can click on this button here. So you select the serial numbers that you want to export into a spreadsheet. And you click on this button here. It's like a square with the arrow going out. And what this does is it takes the view, the grid the radio view, and it sends it to a file. And you can see here that by default, it uses this .csv format, which is okay, I guess, but I want to save it as an Excel spreadsheet. So you can save it in Excel 2013 onwards, or sorry, 2010 onwards, or the old Excel type format. It's up to you. So you can pick what format you like, what works for you. And I'm just going to call this file radios. Save. And now if you look at my desktop, there's the file there that I've just created. My desktop background's a bit crazy, but there's the file that I've just exported there. And if we open it using Excel, you can see that all the radios are there. So you can go in and you can edit it, or whatever the case may be. Similarly, you can import radios. So I have prepared already a file, and hopefully this works. Let's see. So there's the file that I created earlier. And if I click on open, what it should do, it should import a bunch of serial numbers. Let's keep the fingers crossed that it works, because sometimes, I don't know, sometimes, okay, there it goes. Sometimes Excel does some strange things. And this, I think, mostly happens with this .csv file. Okay, so there you can see I've gone from all the way up to radio 200. And I guess since these are all DP4801Es, you could, for example, say, okay, select an MVO. Let's use that one. Then. So there's the radios there. We've selected the MVO. I can go now and select a configuration. So make it DP4801E, config one. And now it applies the config, that single config, to all of those radios. And there's the radio aliases done. And I've also done the radio ID, the CHI, and these other parameters here that you need, like passwords and stuff like that. So you could then now write all those radios or export them to offline device programmer and then send it to the radios. Okay, then the last topic I want to look at is we've not really used it much, but one of the things that I use a lot, and more so now since they've made the change, well, let's say improved it, is this function here in the radio view called groups. What you can do here is you can split the radios into, let's say, different folders. Let's call it that. What I can do is, for example, let's say I can say create a new customer, for example. Let's call it customer A. And I can create another customer and call that one, a folder called it customer B. Okay. And in customer A, they have maybe some mobile radios, some DM series radios, and they have some portable radios. Okay. And customer B, they also have the same. And Maybe even they have some repeaters. So then what you do is you just go here to your the top level, the all thing, and you can say, okay, well, these two radios here, and let's say this radio here, this radio, these three radios, they belong to customer A. So I just select them and I click on the drop down and click on customer A. Oops, sorry, I should have done that. Fix that up. So they go to customer A. The repeater is on at customer B, and so is this radio here, as well as these two radios here, for example. Okay, and then the rest, the rest we can put with the one customer. Let's go put an A. Who knows? Let's make it B. Then those we put with, let's put up 230 there. And that's, so try that again. There goes a customer A. Rock. Damn it. Sorry about that. Let's try that again. No, you have to do it one by one. Okay. There's a way of doing them all at a time. So then you go to the customer and you can say, okay, well, I want to have, this is a portable, that's a mobile, that's a portable. So you basically create like a whole hierarchy of folders where each radio is sitting. So if you want to look at, let's say, for example, customer A, and you want to look at the configuration of all of their portables, you don't have to go, you know, searching through all serial numbers here. You just go to customer A, you click on portables, and there are all the radios shown there. You want to see what mobiles, what is the configuration of their mobiles, you just click on that folder there and it's shown there. And you can even go even down to, like, for example, departments. And there is, I think, I don't know what the limit is, how many levels down you can go, but you can go down pretty far, I think. And that allows you to kind of sort this whole radio management database into different departments and into different customers. It just makes, for me at least, I think it makes life a lot easier.